blowing fans to try to get it down below 80 in here. Now it's gotten well below. If you want to just snuggle with the person next to you, feel free. It's okay. It's kind of cool. So, but I'm not turning the heat on yet. I'm not going to do it. So, anyway, welcome to Hope Presbyterian Church. As we snuggle together, let us pray. Precious Lord, we love you. We thank you that you are here. That you fill this place as you fill our hearts as we gather together. And we just ask for your blessings on us this morning. And open our minds and our hearts to you. And most of all, let us adore you. Let us grow in our knowing you and appreciating you. And just celebrating you. Let us worship you this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right, if you open your bulletin, you will find any number of announcements. For this week, between now and next Sunday, nothing extra new or grand or exciting going on, just kind of some of our usual stuff. But next Sunday, super new and exciting and grand. Very exciting. I can feel it already. First of all, we're kicking off our adult Sunday school class. We've had a little hiatus for the last month and change. And we're going to jump back into the Sermon on the Mount. Before I went on sabbatical, we had gotten through the Beatitudes, and now we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of Jesus' just amazing sermon. So if you have been a part of the Sunday school class, hopefully we'll see you back. If you haven't, it begins at 8:30, and it's a good time. It's a good time. We have a good group, and we really chew on the Word of God, and it's pretty cool. So, open invitation to whoever wants to be there. We'll start at 8:30, and we'll try to, it's about an hour and a little bit, but we'll try to get out of there by about 9:30. And then, after Sunday school and after worship, we're going to end up at the Northrops right around 1 p.m. for the all-church barbecue potluck. They live about, 7 miles out? About 7 miles, I think. Yep. Go out East Evans or West Evans. It all can. And they live at 100 Minthorn Road. And it's a great place to gather together. We've had a number of events there now. So we do have a sign-up sheet out there. And we are providing, Joy Fellowship, right? Joy Fellowship, yes?
Yes. We're providing all hamburgers and hot dogs, chips, beverages, all that good stuff. A lot of fun. Mark Beverly will have a pool open today.
Yeah.
After it's a little warm, he's got walnut trees all over the place, a lot of shade.
Right.
Up there,
he's
got a bunch of walnut trees. But a lot of fun. There'll be badminton, there'll be water toss.
Toss. Good. Yeah, so I'll be at Warner. It gives us a little time to. I'll keep the sermon really short, actually. And then, yes, Deb.
Please sign up.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's what I'm getting to. Do let us know if you're coming. The last time I checked, there wasn't a whole lot of names on that list, including my own. So please sign up and let us know you're coming. It's a great time of fellowship that we have together. So but do let us know. We'll have plenty of food for you. And do plan on bringing something. It has got the potluck aspect to it. Sides, salads, desserts, anything you want to come up with, be cool. Okay? So that's coming up next Sunday. Now you look on the announcement side, there's a number of things. I just want to touch on them very quickly. PBC is Pacific Bible College. I just started on Monday, last Monday, teaching my Old Testament class. I had a great first class. But they are doing something that's kind of cool. It's They're called the koinonia, which is Greek for the household, like the kind of like the whole household of God idea. The koinonia lecture series, and they're kicking that off this Tuesday from 6 to 8 at their campus. And Rick Buya, I've known Rick for a long time, I don't know how to pronounce his last name.
Buya.
I always think of Buya, and that could be good. That's a good thing. So, but Rick is awesome. I adore that man, and he's going to talk on the myth of secularism. So that's coming up this Tuesday at 6, and it's free. So the information's there. Coats, blankets, and bags. We're going to hear more about that soon, but we do want to give you a heads up that we will be collecting those things on September 27th, so in a few weeks from now. Abide Project. Hopefully you got stuff in the mail. If you didn't get stuff in the mail, I got some extra packets on the entryway. But do get your, if you want to participate in the Abide Project, awesome. That's what we're hoping for. But do get your forms, and I'm starting to build, kind of strategize where we'll have meeting times, when we'll have meeting times, I should say, and the groups. So that's an important part of pulling this together. So please get your form in ASAP, so we can do that. Okay? We have a note that you can't take it with you. It's a good reminder of our value system and this. No, it's also a play. The Barnstormers are going to be putting on You Can't Take It With You, and we are going to go to it on Sunday, September 20th at 2 p.m. is when the show is. One of the real draws to this particular play, this particular show, is Jane Ann Rowley's granddaughter, Hallie. Some of us have known Hallie since she was, you know, really short. She is starring in the play, which is so exciting. She graduated. I think she graduated, right? She graduated from SOU.
No,
not yet.
She's junior.
Julia, junior? Mm-hmm. All right. I'll take your word for it.
And Ryan.
Yes.
Want an extra book for a friend, please let me know that if you're ready to go. So I'm excited to share.
childcare available, and it's going to be a great study for the interim. It starts in 24.
Woo-hoo. All right. Awesome. Anything else? Great. Well, let us enter into worship together with the call to worship. There. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me.
Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me.
Amen. Please stand and worship together this morning. Feel free to clap and move around and warm up, stretch. Most of all, just take some time out of your schedule to make sure we're worshiping our Lord, right?
Stay the same through the ages.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Identifies us as followers of Jesus. And all of this is working towards what I want to focus on through the fall. Actually, what I want to begin next Sunday. And that is taking 1 Corinthians 13 apart piece by piece and see what it has for us and how it can guide us as we seek to answer Jesus' call to live in love. Now, in preparation for this, I want to take this morning and tackle 1 Corinthians 13 as a whole, as a chapter, and reflect on what it shows us about love. So let's look at 1 Corinthians 13. We're going to read the whole thing, verses 1 through 13. It's a really cool chapter. Hear the word of the Lord. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all that I have, if I deliver up my body that I may boast of my sacrifice, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but love rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now, faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Precious Lord, we love you. And we want to grow in your love. So be with us as we meditate on your word. And do a work in our hearts and in our minds, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so I love the Bible. I really do. It is the Word of God. I've spent a lot of my life studying the Bible, working with the Bible, and I've been so blessed through it. But who's kidding who? There are some parts of the Bible that are downright scary. If I was going to make a list of the top 10 scariest verses of the Bible, I could come up with some pretty good options. And I can tell you this, that number 4 would definitely be Matthew 12, 36 to 37. Which says, and this is Jesus talking, I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word that they speak. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Yeah. Yikes. Thinking about being judged by our words, especially by our careless words, is a little scary. It's got like number 4 rating of scariness. And it makes me wonder what Jesus thinks about how we use our words today. About how we mangle our own language. Like the word awesome. The word awesome means to cause awe, something that causes awe. And what is awe but an overwhelming sense of fear and wonder? That's awesome. Ever since Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, we have been throwing around the word for anything that we just simply really enjoy or like or think is pretty good. We talk about awesome movies and awesome books and awesome songs. And if a day happens to have some nice weather, we say it is an awesome day. Right? If we say that was an awesome meal, we probably don't literally mean that that hamburger and fries we just ate gives us an overwhelming sense of fear and wonder. We just liked it. Broke is another word that I hear a lot. When people can't afford something, or when they're just looking for an excuse not to do something or participate in something, they say, sorry, but I'm broke. But broke doesn't mean being budgeted. Broke means broke. It means you don't have two dimes to rub against each other. If you have a roof over your head and clothes on your back and food in your belly, you're not broke. Okay? Just by definition. Sick is another word. I've noticed that oftentimes when I hear the word sick used, people are not actually talking about the impact of viruses or bacteria or toxins. Instead, sick means something that's really great, something that's cool and exciting and cutting edge. Man, that was sick, right? Stop there. Let's pray. No. There are all kinds of words that we either misuse or overuse, and the result is that they lose their meaning. They lose their effectiveness to communicate. They lose their significance. I think the word love is in danger of becoming one of these words. We use the word love in all kinds of ways. We use it to describe how we feel about certain flavors of ice cream, about certain television shows. We use the word love to describe how we feel about a particular make and model of an automobile. And at the same time, we use love to talk about how we feel about our spouse and our children and about the Lord and Creator of the universe. And too often, we express love one minute and not so much love or even hatred the next minute. Depending on how our ice cream tastes, or how our TV show's season wraps up, or how our car is running, or how our spouse and our children make us feel, or how God is fulfilling our desires, is whether or not we're actually going to love them or hate them. What we call love ends up being selfishness. And as such, by definition, isn't really love. Considering all that we have said over the last several weeks about love and the high value that God places on it, it's really, really good that God offers us a basic working description of just what he means by the word. Of just what he wants to see lived out in our lives. And God does this throughout the Bible. But nowhere does he do it in as detailed a way as in 1 Corinthians 13. This one chapter offers us some defining truths about the basic qualities of love. So, what does 1 Corinthians 13 say about love? About love in general, with broad strokes. First, and so importantly, 1 Corinthians 13 tells us that love is relational. This might seem like one of those duh kind of statements. Like I'm stating the obvious, but I'm not. The thing is, love is always relational. It's always active. It's always interactive. It's how we relate to each other, how we value each other, and how we act on that value. Love is as much or more a verb than it is a noun. This is why 1 Corinthians 13 says stuff like love is patient, love is kind, love isn't envious or boastful or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. That's because love is defined, it's recognized by how it is being lived out in relationship. I think about all the times that people say that they love each other and then they treat each other horribly. They put each other down. They take from each other. They do harm to each other. And when all the damage is done, they say, "But you know, I love you, right?" And the answer is no. You are not loving someone when you are hurting them out of your own selfishness. You cannot claim to love them if you do not live in a loving way towards them. You might like them. You might feel affection for them. You might even feel an overwhelming sense of euphoria when you're in their presence. But you do not love them if you are not relating to them with love. Please say, "I love you," as awesomely. Say it with awesomeness. But say it as often as possible. But when you say "I love you," mean "I am loving you." Do you see the difference? I am actively living out my love for you. I am demonstrating to you patience and kindness and selflessness in my relationship with you. So, one big broad stroke thing that 1 Corinthians 13 tells us is that love is relational. It also tells us that love is foundational. In some ways, this is the biggie. This is really the main point of 1 Corinthians 13. And that is, if what we do isn't done with love, if it isn't built on love as its foundation, then ultimately, it's worthless. In the end, it will fall. In some ways, this is stating the obvious. When people do unloving things, when they lie and cheat and steal from each other, and when they bully and abuse and batter each other, and when they force their own will, regardless of the harm that's going to be done to the other, it's pretty easy to see that there's a problem. And not too many people would put up with it for long. The trouble is, when we do good things, but do them without love, when we do things with the wrong motives, then it's tougher to sort out. And we can do all kinds of good things. We can feed the hungry. We can clothe the naked. We can build homes for the homeless. But if we do it without love, if we do it for our own glory, or for us to finagle some gain out of it for ourselves, or to put others in our debt and so have a control over them, then it is empty. Then ultimately it will cause more harm than it will good. 1 Corinthians 13 lists all kinds of great things we can do, like speaking in the tongues of angels. That would be pretty awesome. Awesome. I say it all the time. I do. It would be awesome, though, in a way, because it would cause a sense of overwhelming wonderness, right? So it would be awesome. Yeah. If we speak in the tongues of angels, if we move mountains with our faith, if we offer ourselves up in martyrdom, all of that is great. But over and over, 1 Corinthians tells us that whatever we do, if it's done without love, then it's worthless. And the result is nothing. This reminds me of the eighth scariest verse in the Bible. Matthew 7:22-23, where Jesus said, "On that day, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness.'" That's scary. Because these guys did all kinds of great stuff. They did miraculous stuff. But clearly they did it with the wrong motives. They did it without love. And Jesus denied them. He rejected them. I think that's scary. But on the other hand, if we are motivated by love, if love is the substance of what we do, if it's the foundation on which we build, then we will see miracles. We will cast out demons and dispel the darkness. We will bring healing and new life. We will see mountains move and the glory of God break forth. Through the power of God's love, we will see lives changed. Over and over in the Bible, we are called to examine ourselves, to test our hearts, to be honest about our motivations that are behind our actions. As we pursue living in love in all of our relationships with our family, our relationships with our friends, our relationships within our church and our community and everywhere, let us examine ourselves. Let us test the motivations behind our actions and let us see if love really is our foundation as we seek to build up those around us above and beyond ourselves. So, love needs to be our foundation. Now, if love is our foundation, then we will discover another quality of love, and that is that love is exponential. Love grows. Love expands. Love connects us with greater things. I think one of the problems with how we typically approach love is that we are too short-sighted. We only think about the present, the immediate impact of our love. We focus on whether or not we will make someone feel happy now, or feel loved and affirmed now, or satisfy their needs for now. And all of that is great. But love is bigger than that. Jesus said God's love is like a mustard seed. It starts off really, really small, but it grows. Jesus said God's love is like yeast. You start off with just a little pinch of it, but it spreads. It has the potential of literally filling everything. The exciting thing about living in love is that we have no idea about the impact that we are having. We have no idea about the impact we are having on the person that we are loving, or on the people in their life, or on the generations that are to come. One of the verses in the Bible that isn't scary at all is 1 Corinthians 15:58, where it says, "Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." Isn't that encouraging? Isn't that inspiring? Isn't that awesome? And I really mean awesome at times. Jesus once said, "Store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal." Did you ever wonder what a treasure in heaven is? A treasure in heaven is what we do for God. It's our living out His love together. And here's the thing. Love is eternal. Whenever we love each other, we are doing something that will last for all eternity. Nothing can steal it. Nothing can destroy it. Love is never in vain. It is eternal. Love belongs to God. He cherishes it. He nurtures it. He does great things with it. Mother Teresa is one of my heroes. The teeny, tiny, little Armenian nun shared the love of Jesus with literally millions of people. And one of my favorite quotes of Mother Teresa's is, "Not all of us can do great things, but we all can do small things with great love." But when we do anything with love, it becomes great in the hands of God. All of this is why 1 Corinthians 13 says, "Faith, hope, and love endure, and the greatest of these is love." This is why 1 Corinthians 13 says, "Love never fails." Right now, we only see things dimly, but the day is coming when we will see things fully. We will know how God expanded all of the little ways that we shared His love. We will see how He grew it, how He expanded it, and how He changed lives with it. Love is exponential. It is eternal. It is powerful stuff. Last week we talked about Jesus' command to love one another as I have loved you. And everything we are talking about today comes from that command. Jesus loves us so much that He said that we could compare His love for us with the love of God the Father for Him, which is just mind-blowing. And Jesus' love wasn't abstract. Jesus didn't sit around and just talk about His love. He showed us His love with His actions. He lived His love out in relationships. Jesus came to this fallen world. He entered our broken condition. He spent His time and His energy teaching us and healing us and liberating us. Jesus lived out His love in the greatest way possible. He suffered mockery and rejection and betrayal and beatings and scourgings and a crown of thorns. And then Jesus suffered the agony of crucifixion, in the cold sting of death, and the crushing weight of all of our sins laid upon Him. And Jesus suffered it all willingly because of His great love for us and His desire to do us the greatest good. The love of Jesus is truly relational, and it is the foundation of everything that He has done. And it's His whole strategy that His love would be exponential. It would grow and spread within us and through us. It would fill all the world, storing up eternal heavenly treasures. May we open our hearts to Jesus. May we receive His love with joy and put His love into action together. This is our highest calling. And this is our greatest joy. And it really is totally awesome. Let's pray together. Precious Lord, we know what You have called us to. We know that You have called us to something that seems impossible. To live out Your love. But as we've seen over the last number of weeks, with You, the impossible can be possible. With Your love alive in our hearts, we can live in Your love together. Help us to embrace Your love, to allow it to infuse our hearts and our lives so that it overflows in all those around us. Help it to grow exponentially as we exercise eternity together. We love You. We praise You in Jesus' name. Amen.
We stand and worship together.
Let's take a few minutes in prayer together. I know that there are things we need to be lifting up to the Lord together. And Eric Epstein, did we get off okay yesterday?
Yeah, police in Rwanda are 1/3 of the way to Colorado right now. And they were laughing at the fact that there were doggies crossing the sign and stuff.
Keep your eyes on you, shine your light on your students. walk with them throughout this week. Jesus, we do ask this now.
Father, I'd like to pray for our friend Cindy, who's very, very sick. She's on her body, so I'm going to pray for her. But God, don't have that. She's just very, very friendly and helpful to you. And she's just needing your love and your grace for you.
Lord, I hope that James, sister, very well, to be very perfect and I thank you, Lord, for comforting her and giving her peace about all of this.
Strength and protect them and help we can protect others. All we can do is work hard and look to you, Lord. Not only with the Ron and Jeanette hat, as they get ready to travel to Nepal tomorrow. I think it's about a month there. Thank you for the opportunity of this trip. If you have been anxious to be with these people that they've known and loved and worked with for so many years, particularly in the aftermath of all the earthquakes, the devastation that they have brought. Just pray for them, give them strength and safety, and let them be an instrument of your love, an instrument of your joy and peace as they seek to encourage and build up their dear friends. Lord, we lift all these prayers to you, confident in your love, and responding to your love by loving each other. As we lift each other up to you. And Lord, as we pray all these things, we pray the prayer that your Son taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Amen. All right. Let's prepare our hearts. Be prepared to share in great communion with our Lord. Pray together. Precious Lord, we love you so much. And we are here because of what this bread and this cup represent. Your greatest act of love, your greatest gift of grace to us, for the body and blood of your Son. We thank you. We put our trust in your love, in your grace, in your presence and power. We give you our hearts and our lives as we seek to commune with you. Praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. On the night that our Lord was betrayed, he gathered his disciples together to share with them in one final supper. And in the course of that supper, our Lord took bread, and he broke the bread, and gave the bread to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, formed through the shedding of my blood for the forgiveness of sins." As we take of the bread and of the cup, let us remember what our Lord has done for us. Let us be mindful and receptive to his presence with us even now. And let us look forward with anticipation and joy to the great celebration in his kingdom and the age to come. Amen. table, please come forward and share in the bread, the cup. If it's difficult for you to come forward, just give Carrie a little wave and she'll bring the elements to you. Come and share in our Lord together.
Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me and stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me and stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood. Righteousness for me and stands in my defense. And Jesus, it's your blood. Thank you.
Let's pray together. Precious Lord, it is so good to receive from you what we need the most, true nourishment, spiritual food, to receive you, body and blood, living love poured out for us. We give you our thanks. We give you our praise. We honor you. And we ask that as you have invested in us, you would use us to make eternal investments in those around us with your love. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Let's invite you to stand together and worship God and thank him for how much he loves us. I'm forgiven. You were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven.
Amazing love, how
Some time to figure out exactly what that looks like, but that's the nuts and bolts of it, to live His love together. And Eric, did you raise your hand for...
Yeah, I just wanted to let you all know that you're invited to come to our house on Saturday. It's our last thing to give everybody hugs and load up the moving truck, and from 10 to 3 is what we have kind of set up. We'll have pizza, our contact information for the restaurant.
Okay, good. Thanks. Yeah, I'm glad we got that in. So Saturday, 10. Okay. All right. Opportunity to live out the love of God right there. Load a moving truck. So, but towards that end, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our Heavenly Father, the presence and power of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.
Amen.